and complete their task. Now, and that can be done by using pthread join. So this is the new thread ID which should go for the execution, and this is the status, and the new thread which finishes, karano, the ID gets stored here, and this is status. When the thread finishes, karano, its execution, its exit status or the termination status gets stored into this argument. Now I have the example now. So this is what the new thread, this is a function, karano, which should be executed by the thread that is newly created. So I'm including pthread.h, so stdlib, stdio.h, void star, because I'm making it as an universal pointer, new thread, so thread arguments, karano, so this. So when a new thread is created, karano, I want that new thread to perform this particular function. And what it does, inside the loop, I'm saying printf, hello, I am in a new thread. Now wait for some time, do nothing, karano, and repeat, karano. So for how many times? 5 times it says I am in a new thread. And this is the delay, some delay, because after printing this time message, I make my thread wait for some time, karano. And this can also be replaced by using the sleep function. There is a built-in function sleep that can be used if you don't want to use that for loop. Next is the main function. Okay, now here I'm creating the pthread underscore t tcp. This pthread is a pthread underscore t is a data type. So this is the TCP. Why I've taken it as TCP? Task control block. Now pthread create. So TCP, because to this it returns the ID of the newly created thread, and null attributes I'm making null, and this is the function that should be called, karano, that should be called by the new thread. So the new thread that is created, it should perform the execution of this function new thread. So that is what the function name I've given, and I'm not passing any argument to that, null. In case, karano, some error, karano, the thread creation error happens, it will come inside and it says error in creating a new thread and return -1. And after that, karano, what will happen? New thread is created, and the new thread will go for performing the execution of this, and we have the main thread, so repeatedly doing this. Hello, I am in main thread, karano, so it prints this. I'm the main thread, and it keeps printing this, and we have the thread, karano, one thread, newly created thread, performing this part of the code. Main thread is doing this, and the other thread, karano, the newly created thread, is doing this part of the program. And then as usual, we have, after the main thread finishes doing this, what it will do, it will just come here, it will make a call to pthread join, and keeps itself waiting, karano, blocked here until the other thread finishes its execution. Now that is what the pthread, this is the program, one simple program which you should know. The syllabus of this program is also there. Apart from the pthreads, there are other threads also, that is Win32 threads. You might have already know these things, Win32 APIs, Windows 32 APIs. Now these are the threads supported by various flavors of Windows operating system. And there is Windows 32 application program programming interface libraries, and using these libraries you can go for creating the threads, karano, with this, and they work on all flavors of the Windows operating system, so they might not work on the other operating system like Linux or Fedora. And we have Java threads also, the threads which are supported by the Java programming language, and the Java thread class, thread, karano, it is defined inside this package, the well-known package java.lang. And then yeah, that's it. And then thread preemption, when the CPU is allocated to some thread for execution, karano, you can forcibly take back the CPU from the running thread. So act of forcibly taking back the CPU from the running thread is called as thread preemption. So the act of preempting the currently running thread, karano, or stopping temporarily is called as thread preemption. So preemption is nothing but forcibly taking back something. Now the forcibly taking back the CPU from some running thread is known as thread preemption. Now it is performed for sharing the CPU time among all other threads. Why you got to do thread preemption? Why you got to forcibly take back the CPU from the thread that is currently executing? In order to just give the fair chance for the other threads also to perform the execution. And thus execution switching among the thread is known as thread context switching. So in the previous class I told process context switching similarly, so it is called as thread context switching. When the CPU switches from one thread to the another thread, we call it as thread context switching. If the CPU switches from one process to the other process, we call it as process context switching. So thread context switching is much faster than compared to the process context switching, because here the address space need not be changed. Now we have again two types of thread. One is user level thread and the one is the kernel level thread. So user level thread, as the name itself states, they do not have the kernel of the operating system support. So they exist only in the running process. So they exist only within the running user process. A process may have multiple user level threads, but the OS treats it as a single thread. Now process, inside the process, user level process, there are many threads running, but OS is going to treat it as one single thread, and which will not switch the execution among the different threads for it. Now it is the responsibility, CPU is not responsible for switching the execution from one thread to the another thread. So but it is the responsibility of the process to schedule, you know, after this thread who has to execute next. But when it comes to the question of process, it is the responsibility of the CPU. But when it comes to the question of thread context switching, it is not the responsibility of the CPU. Instead, it is the responsibility of the process itself, because we have a process is a container for the threads. And CPU decides, you know, which process. When process context switching, the CPU decides which process, you know, should execute next. But the thread who should execute next is decided not by the CPU, it is by the process. Now kernel level or system level thread, kernel level threads are also called as system level threads. So they live inside the kernel address space, and the kernel level threads are individual units of execution with the OS treats as separate threads. Now every process, you know, which are there inside the kernel, so they are treated as a separate thread. And there are many ways of binding user level threads with the kernel level system threads. So there are three models. One is many to one model, that means many user level threads are mapped to one single kernel level thread, and one to one model where each user level thread is mapped to one kernel level thread, and many to many model. In this model, user level threads are allowed to be mapped to many kernel level threads. So these are the three models for mapping the user level threads to the kernel level threads. So now the differences between the threads and the process, as I already told, thread is a lightweight process and process is an heavyweight. Now because each process lives inside its address space, if I create one more duplicate copy of the same address space, so there is separate address space, totally different address space created, you know, two processes and they have two different address spaces. But when I say thread, so if I create 100 threads for the same process, all the 100 threads, they will be sharing the same address space. That means they live in the same address space. Now a single thread is a single unit of execution and is a part of a process. A process is an instance of the program, what I can call, and thread do not have its own data memory and heap memory. So they do not have their own data memory, code memory and heap memory. Process has everything its own. A process owns its own code memory, data memory and stack memory. So thread cannot live independently. So this is what is important. A thread cannot live independently. So it lives within the process address space. That means a thread doesn't have its own address space. Now whereas the process can live independently, because every process has its own address space. Now there can be multiple threads in a process. So the first main thread calls the main function and occupies the start of the stack memory of the process. So threads within the process share the code, data and heap memory. Each thread holds separate memory for stack. This is what I told. Every thread has its own stack memory. Threads are very inexpensive to create. They are not expensive because since they live in the same address space, you know, same address space, you can accommodate any number of threads. So hence it is inexpensive. But processes are very expensive, because every time you create a process, a separate address space is created for it. So that is making them expensive. And context switching is inexpensive and fast also. Why context switching is inexpensive for the threads? Because you don't have to change the address space. Without having to change the address space, you can make the CPU simply switch from one process to another process. Here, the address spacing switching is also necessary. Hence, we say it is expensive and also very slow comparative to thread. Hence, thread execution is faster. If a thread expires, the stack is reclaimed by the process. If a process dies, the resource allocated to it are reclaimed by the OS. Here, if a thread dies, all the resource that was taken by the thread will be assigned back to the process. But here, if the process dies, all the resource allocated to the process will be given back to the operating system. So these are the major differences between the thread and the processes. So next is multi-processing and multitasking. Now what is multi-processing? Ability to execute multiple processes simultaneously is called as multi-processing. Systems which are capable of performing multi-processing are known as multi-processor system, because it has multiple processes and it can simultaneously execute multiple processes parallelly. So this is what the multi-processor system has, multiple CPUs. They multiple CPUs are found on the same board or on the same chip. Say for example, you say dual core, quad core, penta core, octa core. Current, they have multiple cores and each core can perform the simultaneous current, parallel execution. Now, ability of the operating system to have multiple programs in memory. So you want to keep all the multiple cores what you have busy. You have to ensure that they have something to execute in parallel. Now, and this can be done by using the concept of multi-programming. That means you should, multi-programming is the concept where you load multiple ready jobs or the processes into the main memory, and the CPUs, what they'll do, they'll start executing some processes, some ready processes, and when that process wants to perform some input-output operation, it simply switches and execute the next process. Now, as long as there is at least one ready process present inside the main memory, now the CPU never sits idle. Now, if I take the uniprocessor system, it was not possible to execute multiple processes simultaneously. Now, multitasking refers to the ability of the operating system to hold multiple processes in memory and switch the processor from executing one process to another process. And multitasking involves something called as context switching, context saving, and context retrieval. Now, what is context switching? So, the process that happens, so context switching has two things, context saving and context retrieval. When the CPU switches from one process to the another process, now it should save the current state of the program which was executed to its PCB, and then it should go for retrieving the context of the process which is it is about to execute next. Now, and the same thing is depicted with this diagram. I have two processes, process 1 and process 2, and here process 1 is running, and now the process 1 stops its execution. It does waits in the ready queue. Say some it's waiting for some input output operation or interrupt. It is waiting in the ready queue. From here it starts waiting in the ready queue. Now the process 2 can execute, but not immediately, so it is idle. Even when the process 1 has entered into the ready state, so process 2 has not started its execution immediately, it is in the idle state. Now what is this? This is the delay in execution of the process 2 happened due to the context switching. That means when it stops executing here, so you got to do context saving. So the current information or the intermediate result of the process 1 should be saved onto its PCB. After that, you should go for reloading. So that is what is written here. Save the current context into PCB 0. So this process current information needs to be saved into its PCB and perform the OS operation related to context switching, and now reload the context of the process 2 from PCB 1. So this process 2's current status should be loaded into the physical registers of the CPU. This is the time taken to do that. And then we have the process 2 running. Now say the process 2 also wants to perform some input-output operation. Now here, immediately, so this was waiting, till here it was waiting inside the ready queue. Now immediately it cannot start running. Now again it is idle for some time. This idle time is called as context switching time. Now what is this again? Now the current status of this process P2 should be saved onto its PCB, and the status which is available in the PCB of the process 1 should be loaded back to the physical registers of the CPU. And time taken to that is called as this idle time, and then we have the process when running. Yeah, that is what is explained. Context switching involves two things: context saving and context retrieval. I hope you people understood what is context switching and context retrieval. So now, types of multitasking. There are different types of multitasking also. One is cooperative multitasking, preemptive multitasking, non-preemptive multitasking. We'll just try to understand what is cooperative multitasking. In cooperative multitasking, the task or the process gets a chance to execute only when the currently executing process voluntarily releases the CPU. So that means, so once in cooperative multitasking, once the CPU is allocated to the process, there is no provision for forcibly taking back the CPU from it or preempting the CPU from it until it voluntarily releases. The next process will get the CPU only when the process which is currently executing releases it. So hence it is called as cooperative multitasking. Why cooperative? Because the other one waits indefinitely until the process which is currently executing voluntarily gives back the CPU. Now that is what is cooperative multitasking. Now, other one is preemptive multitasking. This is opposite to cooperative multitasking. As I told, preemptive is what? Forcibly taking back. Now, in preemptive multitasking, ensures that every process will get a fair chance to execute. Now, what will happen in preemptive multitasking? If some thread or the process is running, so any point of time, the CPU can forcibly take back the OS can take back the CPU and allocate it to the other process for execution. Hence, it is called as preemptive multitasking. Now, what is non-preemptive multitasking? So, the non-preemptive multitasking, it's same as the cooperative multitasking, because non-preemptive, it says you cannot forcibly take back. When the process is executing using the CPU, so you cannot forcibly take back the CPU, and this was same in cooperative process multitasking also. But how non-preemptive multitasking is different from the cooperative multitasking? So it is with respect to the blocked or the waiting state. So when the process which is currently having the CPU in non-preemptive multitasking is executing and that wants to perform some input-output operation, it will be entering into the blocking state or wait state. So that time the CPU can be taken back. So the CPU so the process will go for relinquishing the CPU to the other waiting process. So but here in the cooperative multitasking, even if the process is blocked waiting to perform some input output operation, it's not going to release the CPU to the other process. So that is what is cooperative multitasking. So preemptive multitasking, any point of time, the CPU can be taken back and allocated to the other process or other thread. So in non-preemptive multitasking, when the process the process of the thread is executing, it is not possible for you to preempt, preempt, because it is non-preemptive. Now when it can be preempted, when that process enters into the block state or waiting state to perform some input-output operation, so that time the CPU, it will voluntarily release the CPU for the other waiting process. Hence it is called as non-preemptive multitasking. We'll end here. Today you understood the tasks, processes, and the threads, and the difference between the threads and the processes. I hope you people understood. So with this, I think I have nearly completed 45 to 50% of module 5, and I hope I can complete the entire module 5 in another 4 classes. So thank you.